Sisters Keeper Alumni Panel, Embracing Opportunities and Challenges on Your Career Path. We're blessed to have five fabulous alumni here today. And it's been a reunion for us to see each other too. So I'm going to introduce each of the panelists and the, before she speaks. And we're going to, we have to begin with our most recent graduate, Alyssa Napier. And so we'll each panelist will speak for roughly 10 minutes, and then we'll have a question and answer time after that. And then there'll be time for people to mingle and maybe network. So while at MIT, which was not even a year ago, but feels to her like several decades ago, Alyssa Napier was a course 5 major and a 24 minor. She was active in the Black Women's Alliance, MIT Community Engagement, and her dorm, shout out to House 2. She made good use of MIT's money to travel to Germany twice. You know she wrote it. And she taught chemistry through the TSR, Seminar XL, and ESP's DEL program. Now she develops online courses for MIT's Teaching Systems Lab, which is a mix of video production, instructional and graphic design, and many other skills her chemistry degree did not explicitly prepare her for. Alyssa, thank you.
Hi, everyone. Okay. So I want to preface what I say with two caveats that have affected my experience and my career pathway. So the first is that while I was at MIT, I really did not like MIT. And you know, those of you in the room who know me know this. And so that helped, like a lot of my decision making and a lot of the things that I did were really structured around, you know, changing existing systems and thinking like, how can I never be in a place like this again? And the second caveat is that while I was at MIT, I was solidly middle class. So a lot of my decisions that I made were based on the fact that I knew that, you know, if all else failed, then I would be able to go back home and I would have parents who would be able to take care of me. And so I know that's not the case for everybody, but it influenced the decisions that I was able to make. Okay, so I'm gonna give a brief overview of my career path, starting from my chemistry major and ending up to my developing online courses for educators. And then I also asked other recent graduates for their advice. And one recent graduate is in the room, Grace. She also graduated in 16. And then the other recent graduate, some of you may know, Darren Brown. And so I wanted to get their advice as well because I'm still an infant. I'm still very new to the adult world, and I just wanted to have a well-rounded advice from people who have had different experiences. So while I was at MIT, I was a course 5 major and linguistics minor, and I did chemistry research every summer. The goal was really to eventually go into chemistry grad school, and there's sort of a formula to abide by when you want to go to chemistry grad school. It's sort of like when you're pre-med, you kind of know, okay, so I have to do research, and maybe I should be an EMT. And so, you know, for the formula for chemistry grad school is I have to be doing chemistry research. And I looked at all the other course 5s around me, and they were all doing chemistry research during the semester, and I was doing other things. And this brings it to my first point of advice is notice the things that you are doing. And if they're not the things that people tell you that you should be doing because you're on the path, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's the wrong path for you to do, but it's important to notice. And so I think it, for me, what was really key in figuring out that I didn't want to do chemistry anymore is I noticed what I did that made me proud. So I wasn't proud of the nanoparticles that I was making, or I wasn't proud of like the chemical compounds that I was creating as much as I was proud of the change that I was making at MIT. So while I was here, I was on planning committees for the multicultural conference. That I was proud of. I helped out. I was co-chair of the Black Women's Alliance, and I was really proud of the work that we did there. I was part of the organization People Before Peace Sets. I was proud of that. Black Lives Matter at MIT. I was proud of that. I was not proud of my chemistry work. One, because it wasn't good, but it wasn't good because that was not where I was investing my time. And so my senior year, I realized, I don't want to do chemistry. And that realization was really scary. I'm not going to lie. It wasn't really scary. It was like a relief because chemistry grad school, you talk to any of them and they're miserable, and it was a relief to finally be able to say, oh, I won't be miserable for the next couple of years. That feels really good. What was not necessarily scary, but the friction came when I tried to convince other people that my not being miserable for the next couple of years was a good thing, because my parents were like, well, so what are you going to do? And I was like, I have no idea. So that's another piece of advice, is don't be afraid to say that you don't know what you want to do. I remember my senior year telling everybody, I don't know. Like, they would ask me, and there was a feeling that I need to have an answer. And for a while, I was saying an answer. I think I said something like, oh, I want to do education research, or something like that. And I do want to do education research, but I was giving that answer before I had really decided what I wanted to do. I just felt as though if I don't have an answer, then I have wasted all of my time at MIT. Or if I don't have an answer, then I am not like worthy enough for my degree. It's all of that. You don't have to have an answer. But I will say, you probably do have an answer somewhere in your past. So the things that brought me to my eventual, yes, I want to go into education, were all of the things that I was doing that had nothing to do with my degree. So I was tutoring in Seminar Excel. Hey, Delinda. I was tutoring in Seminar Excel. I worked as an AP chemistry teacher through the Educational Studies program. I don't know if that's still going on. And it was like, those were the things that I was proud of. And so even though I was like, I don't know what I want to do, once I reflected and examined, I really did know what I wanted to do. Okay. So key takeaways. I don't know where I'm with time. Where am I with time? I'll keep talking. Just tell me when to stop. Okay. So key takeaways. The first is that, even though you might be confused, where you are right now is like in a place where people are designed to help you. Guys, when you get out into the world, people, it's not that they don't want to help you, it's just different, right? Here, you've got systems in place to help you. You might feel like you don't have support, but you absolutely have support. Number one, everybody in this room wants to help you. Everybody wants to hook you up with their friend or their acquaintance or their LinkedIn connection, and just get a phone call or something. When I realized that I wanted to do something with education, but I didn't know what, I was asking everybody, hey, do you have somebody that I can just talk to? And maybe it'll turn into a job. It didn't turn into a job for the most part, but just like everybody in here is some sort of resource and they want to help you. You are not a burden to them. I want to help you. I know I don't come over to this part of campus because I don't want to relive a lot of trauma, but if you want to come to my part of campus, I am willing to help you. I told my boss that I really want to take over the Office of Digital Learning with, you know, talented, intelligent Black women, and I mean it. I got Jazz and Nakaya, Europe. Y'all, if you want me, or if you want to work in the teaching systems lab at all, come find me. So that's the first thing, is just use your resources. It's these people are here to help you. All right, so now I'm going to go into my Google Doc of sage advice. Let's see. So not only the resources in this room, but also the explicit resources that are here for career guidance. So I didn't know what I wanted to do or how even to go about doing education research. And so I went to the Global Education Career Development GECD, and they didn't have anybody there for education careers. And that might seem scary, like if you go to their website and you're just like, well, nobody here specializes in what I want to do. If I were a chemical engineer, they'd be able to hook me up. But if you go there, so when I went there, they told me, I have no idea how to help you. Let's figure this out together. And so from there, I was able to get help. And it you will be forging your own path, or you might be forging your own path, but it's okay, just because no one's ever walked the same path from MIT to where you want to go doesn't mean it's not possible. Okay, so after college. So I'll just read what I got. So expect the existential crises. This didn't come from me, this came from Darren. Expect the existential crises. Give yourself time to breathe. Don't despise small opportunities. Have goals, have outlets. Okay, so what I really like from what he has written is don't despise small opportunities. So you right now, for those of you who are in senior year, are actually throughout MIT, people are doing great things. They're founding companies. They're going to work in exotic locations. They're making a ton of money. And you might think that the small things that you're doing don't matter. But when I was my senior year, I went to a middle school in Oakland for a month. And I helped them out with some science curriculum design. And that's not something that, you know, you brag about. I wasn't paid that much. I did go on MIT's dime. And I do brag about that, because, like, milk MIT's money for all it's worth. But that small opportunity has, you know, led to a lot of the goals that I've had today. So don't, like, the small stuff is still useful stuff. And also to have goals. So if you're in a period of confusion and you don't know what you want to do, set yourself small goals that's like research different different jobs that aren't just, you know, doctor or architect or lawyer or something like that. That might be one goal for one day. Or you know, call X amount of people this week. That might be another goal. And so you're inching toward coming to some sort of understanding without necessarily needing to have a definitive answer. Okay, so now I'm going to read from Grace's words, and they're beautiful words. So one thing that I've highlighted is, we are so unbelievably young to be making these kinds of decisions, and it's okay to not know what you want. You guys are young. You are babies. I am a baby. We are all infants. And you do not need to brand yourself with a job right now. Like, you don't need to say, well, when I grow up, I'm going to be Secretary of Education. That's another thing that I was telling a lot of people, right? Like, that's the lofty goal, is I want to be Secretary of Education. And people look at me and they're like, oh yes, this girl, she has labeled herself with a dream. She knows what she wants. She's confident. That's what I thought was coming from that. And that's why I was giving out that answer. But what does that actually mean for me in the coming days, in the coming, not even coming years, coming months? Nothing, right? So we are so unbelievably young to be making these kinds of decisions, and you don't have to decide that you want to be Secretary of Education 40 years from now, today. So the family pressure and the pressure we put on ourselves is real. So try to cut off that pressure at the root by finding and appreciating the non-academic and non-professional contributions that you make to your family and your community. So this is really important, because it was the non-academic contributions that I made to MIT that I am most proud of. I did not make any academic contributions to MIT. I don't think anybody will ever remember me as a chemistry major or even in linguistics, as a linguistics major, but I made tons of contributions to this community that sometimes I have to be continually reminded about because they don't necessarily seem worth anything to me. And so my friends and my mentors have to remind me, like, no, Alyssa, you were worth something while you were here. Just because you didn't contribute anything to the chemistry department doesn't mean that you didn't make a difference and an impact. And the last thing that I'll say is that you might not have heard of the job that you will get when you graduate. So I never thought about who makes online courses, and yet there was a job posting, and I applied, and I got it because I worked with the person as a URL. That's another, like, user resources, right? But this is not a job that, again, when I was little, I would have been like, oh, when I grow up, I want to be a developer of online courses, right? So just because you haven't heard, like, there are so many jobs that exist that you've never heard of that might be something that you really enjoy doing. And so don't just think that it's the job that other people have heard of that's a job that's worth something. So, like, when people ask me, what do? And I say, I develop online courses, everybody's like, oh, what does that mean? Like, what does that entail? Because they've never heard of a job like that. But that doesn't mean that it's any, like, they're not devaluing me just because they've never heard of my job. That's what I've got to say. Thank you.
Director of the Program in Women's and Gender Studies and professor on the writing side of CMSW. I also want to recognize there's a few of my sister's keeper governing committee members here, Latari Canty, and Aida Tambu, and Ama Edo, who is teaching in GSL, got her PhD from MIT last year. Teaching in global studies and languages.
And Chloe Gardner.
Oh, yes, and our student, Chloe Gardner. And we also have Deolinda Rodriguez Branch from the OM Assistant Dean in the Office of Minority Education here. So. And I was fortunate enough to have Alyssa in one of my classes and also to have Khalea in one of my, I think you were both in the fiction workshop. All right, so Khalea Ross Robinson is an associate producer at Face the Nation on CBS. She's a member of the Producers Guild of America, and prior to joining CBS was a producer at Tavis Smiley on PBS. At MIT, Khalea majored in civil engineering and double minored in political science and French, graduating Phi Beta Kappa with a 5.0 GPA. She has worked at the Office of Management and Budget in the Executive Office of the President in Washington, D.C., at the engineering firm IFAGE in France, at the law firm Sullivan & Cromwell in New York, and as staff assistant to the President at MIT. Over the years, Khalea developed a keen interest in media and left the JD program at Harvard Law School to pursue a career in media, and I wish I had played that move instead of following through with their program. When I read that about her, I was like, damn. Khalea was named the 2011 Henry Ford II Scholar by MIT for attaining the highest academic standing in the MIT School of Engineering, and she was an active member of the Black Students Union while a student and at the Institute. She's born in Washington, D.C. and moved to St. Kitts as a young girl. Welcome, Khalea.
Thank you so much, Professor Lee, and thank you, to MIT and your entire program for putting this together. I think this kind of support is so important. Thank you. I guess, firstly, I just want to say, obviously, we've all kind of had an interesting story, and I've switched a lot. Whether or not you decide to continue on your current path, your time at MIT is going to be valuable to you. Obviously, it's a super, super rigorous environment. And you're taught not only how to solve a lot of very challenging problems in rapid succession over and over again for 4 years, but you're also more importantly learning about yourself, your own reserves of strength and endurance, and how to keep pushing. I think the most important lesson that I learned from MIT wasn't a technical one. It was that nothing is out of reach. And it's a lesson that I learned thanks to the Office of Minority Education. There was a dean there named Gail Lenora Staten, who was an incredible force, if anyone knows her. Basically, as Professor Lee mentioned, I grew up in the Caribbean, or I went to high school in the Caribbean, and we didn't have calculus in my high school. We had a very small budget. A lot of our teachers didn't have college degrees. In any case, our system is based off of the British system, which means that when you finish senior year, you're basically finishing 11th grade. So I hadn't gotten calculus. As we all know, MIT, when you start out, you have not only calculus, but you have calculus-based physics as one of your first classes. So when I first came, that was a kind of terrifying prospect. Project Interphase, which was put on by the OME, is an incredible opportunity to kind of get a sense of what your first year is going to be like. When I went there, everybody else had already had calculus, though. And so I felt like, oh my god, everybody else knows everything. How am I going to survive here? And I was about to leave before even starting my first day at the school. And Dean Staten came to my dorm room and told me, don't you go anywhere. You just stick here and stick it out. And I'm so glad that she did that. So I guess the first point is, you know, there are people who care about you. There are people who want to see you succeed, and accept that love when it's given to you. I think, you know, use each opportunity, give it your all, even when it doesn't count. So at Interphase, don't treat Interphase as just a practice run, a dry run. Don't treat your first semester, freshman year, as a dry run because the grades don't count. It does count. It counts for you, for your own practice. It was in Interphase that I was able to realize that even though I felt very scared and terrified, and I thought everybody else understood everything and I didn't understand a thing, it was through that experience that I realized that you could get an A in these classes. And I think that's really what I learned here more than anywhere else, is so much of the early experiences here, it feels like you're kind of blindfolded in the desert, kind of groping for a wall. And until you feel the wall, until you know, you feel the face of that cliff, you don't know it exists. And I think sometimes you just need to know that, yes, I can excel here, not just survive. I can do very, very well here. You need that first indication that that exists as a possibility, and then you'll know how to keep pushing yourself and keep doing that for your 4 years. As far as kind of how you stay grounded here, to me, the most important things, and I know there are things that you're already doing, show up, ask questions. So even if you're doing well, you go to that tutorial services room, you go and you get that tutoring, even if you're already doing well in the class. You go to each office hour, you get to know your professor, you go to the recitations. They have this Zen concept of the beginner's mind, and I think that's an incredibly valuable tool to you. Never think that you've got it. You know, just keep pushing forward with humility. Don't let your goals be set by other people. Don't get your sense of validation from other people either. So, you know, make sure you're setting your own goals. Make sure you're doing your best. That's all that matters. Also, don't let other people set low expectations for you. And sometimes that happens, especially as young women in STEM, young black women in STEM. Make sure that you're expecting the very highest from yourselves, and make sure that your professors and everybody knows that you expect to do very well. Listen to your heart. So now we're talking about like career path. Basically, I've had a very circuitous path, but I think ultimately I wouldn't change a thing about it. So when I was about 7 years old, I wanted to be a civil engineer because I thought bridges were the most captivating things in the world. They were made of concrete and steel, so they were extremely heavy and dense, but at the same time, they were so beautiful and so elegant, and they seemed to glide and to float. And something about that contradiction, that juxtaposition, I don't know, just was like the most glorious thing in the world to me. So I wanted to study civil engineering, and I did. My first working experience, was the summer before my senior year, and that was in France. That's when I realized I didn't want to be a civil engineer anymore, because the day-to-day in a firm is completely different from what you're studying in school. And at that point, I didn't know what to do. So I was kind of senior year, now, you know, what am I going to do with the rest of my life? I'm going to finish this degree, that's what I know, and I don't know what else. Everybody else I knew was going to a PhD program or kind of had a job already lined up, and I had a gigantic question mark. So I worked here at MIT in the office of the president for a year. I applied to law school because law school seemed like the thing that you apply to when you don't know what to do with your life. I went to law school, and on the very first day, I could tell from the very first class that this is not where I belonged. It was like my soul was like slowly dying and retracting with each new line that was being read of this random property case. I was like, what am I doing here? But I stuck with it for 3 weeks. Ultimately that was the wrong decision for me, but sometimes, and this is the other lesson, sometimes the wrong decision will lead you to the right one, so don't be afraid to make the wrong decision. It was in law school, feeling how wrong that was for me, that I felt finally there was enough of a push to move into media. You mentioned, you know, listening to yourself and seeing what makes you feel proud as an undergrad. The two best experiences for me as an undergrad were things that had nothing to do with my coursework, and they were both media related. One was a random elective I was taking in the urban studies class, where we had to put together like a little film project, and I felt so incredibly overjoyed doing that. The other was a project for the BSU called the Presidential Priorities Initiative, where we got together people from freshmen all the way up to PhD students, and we all kind of put together a video presentation that we sent out to all the presidential candidates saying, these are the issues that matter to our community, and we'd like you to address them. And something about the production of that, the lights and the cameras, I was just feeling very alive. And, ultimately that's what I do now. So, again, I think had it not been for law school, I would not have kind of stomped on the brakes and really did a 180 and followed my dreams. Basically, that's it for me. Thank you.
Affiliated with psychology at the Whitman School of Management, Syracuse University. She received her Bachelor's of Science from MIT and her doctorate from the Kellogg School of Management at Northwestern University. Her research examines the influence of worldviews related to economic success on consumer behavior. Currently, it focuses on how perceptions of access and lack of access to economic opportunities affect how consumers pursue and allocate money. Her work appears in various marketing and consumer behavior journals and has been featured in MIT's Sloan Experts and the Financial Times. Breagin directs the Behavioral Lab at Whitman, where she trains students and supports faculty conducting experimental and interdisciplinary social science research. In 2015, she gave the faculty charge at Syracuse University's and SUNY ESS New Students Convocation, which is a top teaching and mentorship honor at the university. She enjoys traveling, dancing, and reading. Welcome.
Hi, everyone. I'm Breagin. Thank you so much, Dr. Lee. So my path to MIT, I think, was a bit different from most people's. I'm from Atlanta, and it's a great city in a wonderful state with a lot of problems. I did not go to one of the high schools that MIT recruited from. I had very little connection with this world, but I was in a math science magnet program at my high school, and I was insanely young. And that kind of stood out to people. And my mom was very proud of me, and she would talk to people, you know, oh, my kid, she's kind of smart. You know, she took the SAT in middle school, did really well, kind of smart. You know, and eventually one of those conversations led me to be a student at the Math Institute of Atlanta, which I'm pretty sure is defunct. But it was started by a professor at the University of Arkansas, Pine Bluff, whose son, Malik King, had just graduated from MIT. And he said, you know, your daughter is pretty smart. Has she ever heard of this program called MITES? The deadline's in a week. So I got my first introduction to MIT through the MITES program. I still remember very vividly, Malik read my essay for MITES and called, and my mom told him that I was washing my hair, and he explained to her that this was not a date request and that I needed to get on the phone, and he had heard this excuse before. And I talked to Malik. That was the very first phone conversation I've ever had with deep conditioner in my hair, and it was the first of many. So here I am. I did Project Interphase. I graduated from high school at 16 years old, and I graduated from here at 20. And while I was here, 17 years ago, my mom died of breast cancer. And so my road here was really hard. So I echo what Alyssa said earlier when she talked about the resources that this institute has for you. I had never heard of a counselor or a therapist, but Dean Aida back there still remembers me. And she opened her door to me and opened her heart to me and really took me in and reminded me that I was here for a reason and for a purpose. And so I wandered around aimlessly for quite a while. I was very curious, and I always wanted to be something other than a math major. And eventually I figured out what that was. I went to Sloan, and you know I have a doctorate, and you know that the business school is pretty much an applied degree. So here's this weirdo 16-year-old kid bopping around Sloan, wearing a Gap sweatshirt, because that was in at the time. It was very fashionable. Some yellow Tims talking about wanting to be a professor and a researcher in business. And it was weird, you know, like the five undergraduate classmates that I had were all going to Goldman. You know, they were like, we are on our way. We're going to be consultants. It's going to be amazing. And I was like, yeah, I'm going to grad school. I'm going to like dress like that guy. So I kind of wandered, you know. I took philosophy classes. I took writing classes and political science classes. And my first Europe here was looking at rhetoric after Kennedy's executive order for affirmative action. I looked at the rhetoric that the president used to speak to Congress and the Senate. The House of Representatives and the Senate. So that's pretty much what I did. And I loved it. And then I got another Europe working for a professor who I liked, but we didn't have a working relationship. He was in the business school, and I went to him because he looked like me. And that is the first time I realized that looking like somebody and working well with them is not necessarily the same thing, right? So it didn't work out, which is fine, right? It was a very important lesson. The person who ended up sort of being my mentor into my profession is a guy named Drajan Prelik, who's probably still on faculty at Sloan. He wore a white shirt and khaki pants every day, and he used a Mac. And I thought, that guy looks really happy. I want to go talk to him because he's working here. And as Alyssa noted, there are a lot of sad faces around these parts, right? So he looked happy. I went in after office hours, or at office hours, and we had a really great conversation that really set me on my path. Now, while I was here, I had never heard of a behavioral economist. I knew that I took some course 14 classes, and I was not excited. And when I took my Sloan classes, I got a bit happier, right? It vibrated. You know that feeling where you found joy and you don't know what it is? Mm-hmm. That's the feeling that I had in my classes. And so that's how I knew I was where I needed to be. Now, I still didn't have a path, so enter mentor here, who explains to me how you get a PhD in business and all of these things. And I thought it was strange and awesome, and that's what I did. And I thought it would be a really good idea to get a master's in statistics along the way. So I applied for a program, I got in, and 2 weeks in, I was like, nope. Let's go ahead and get this GMAT going. I'm about to drop out of school. So I applied to graduate school probably in the span of 4 weeks. All of my letters of recommendation writers were angry. So lesson two, please give people at least 6 weeks to write you a letter of recommendation. It's so important. But they they wrote my letters anyway, and I ended up doing really well on the GMAT. I worked at Kaplan as sort of a break. You know, I learned how to read scholarly articles. I did, you know, those things that you should do when you are on the path to that kind of a career. It was not necessarily easy, right? But I was, for better or for worse, really comfortable being different. And in my career, that means I often walk into rooms 2, 3, 4 times the size of this one, and I am the only Black person, and I am one of 3 women, and at least 50% of the people in the room came from another country, and by another country, I'm like completely negating this entire like hemisphere, right? No North and South America, no Caribbean. I'm talking about people who come from countries that I have just learned to place on a map, okay? That's the world I live in. And if I hadn't gotten through this place, I don't know that I could get through that, right? Sometimes I look at my brass rat and I remember, like, you've been through worse than this. Like, you have actually succeeded in situations that are more challenging and more difficult than this. And you have faced off with people who discounted you even more than every person in this room. The other thing I'll say is that there is a real, we call it a gender penalty in life. The best piece of advice I got as an academic was actually from Princess Imakwata. I don't know how many of you know her, but she's class of 02.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Well, all right then. All right. So, yes, Kimmy, yes. So Princess said to me the last time I saw her, she said, you know, I don't publish under Princess. I publish as P.I. Imakwata. And I was like, yeah. So now I publish as B.K. Riley. It turns out that men get cited more than women. But my promotion and my success depends on citations, right? So I play this game. And I've gotten more comfortable playing these kinds of games. And I'm not saying it's right, but I am saying that there is a sort of way of socially navigating that you figure out along the way. Pay attention. You know, listen to people when they give you tiny pieces of advice, right? When you see people hiding their pregnancy, ask them why. There are some real obstacles that we face because of who we are when we show up in the room, right? And so some of the best pieces of advice I got were things around guarding against those biases, acknowledging when the expectations of you are low, and sort of bracketing that, right? Being aware of what the people around you might be assuming, and then letting those roll off your back. You belong in every room you enter. Mm-hmm. And as long as you remember that, you will be fine.
Ayanna T. Samuels, a native of Jamaica, is an international development professional who has run a consultancy practice for the last 12 years, specializing in A, the intersection of gender, ICTs, and STEM policy, and B, the use of information and communication technologies, ICTs, and technology policy as enablers of access to basic human rights, socioeconomic empowerment, and poverty eradication. Presently, she's the Jamaica-based World Bank consultant for the bank's regional Caribbean Mobile Innovation Project, and is also the Jamaica Business Development Lead at M-Survey, an innovative mobile technology company which allows one to engage in conversations at scale. Ayanna holds 3 degrees from MIT, and a MSc in Technology Policy, a Master's in Science in Aerospace Engineering, wherein in 2005, she was the first Black woman since 1972 to earn that degree, and a Bachelor's of Science in Aerospace Engineering with Information Technology. She has pursued further studies focused on the creation of effective ICT policy for development. She has coordinated research for several distinguished international clients, including the World Bank, the Caribbean Development Bank, the International Development Bank, the Caribbean Association of National Telecommunications Organizations, CARICOM, the Caribbean Telecommunications Union, the Latin American and Caribbean Network Information Center. This is a workout. The International Telecommunications Union and the Commonwealth Telecommunications Organization, I think I got lost here. At the International Institute for Communications and Development, the Government of Jamaica's Ministry of Science and Technology, the St. Lucia Coalition of Services Industries, and the Telecommunications Trinidad and Tobago. Ayanna has delivered numerous international talks on gender equity in the Caribbean's ICT sector and was invited by the World Bank in 2016 to be a member of the selection committee for the Women's Innovation Network of the Caribbean's Entrepreneur Acceleration Program, which spanned numerous Caribbean countries. As the only Caribbean woman to author a chapter in the successful 2016 book entitled The Internet of Women, Accelerating Culture Change, Innovation, and Change in Education, which featured women from over 30 countries, she is indubitably making her mark as a pioneer in the Caribbean ICT movement. She also co-authored a chapter in the book Studies in Media and Communications entitled Gender Equity and Access in the Caribbean ICT Sector in 2016. Ayanna has served on two Government of Jamaica boards, namely the National ICT Advisory Council and the Public Sector Transformation Committee. She's also an international motivational speaker who speaks English and French and is a health and wellness advisor. Turning to her athletic side, Ayanna is an award-winning international bodybuilding and fitness athlete, a multi-medal winning 5K and 10K runner, studied ballet for 12 years, and is training for her first triathlon in April of this year.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Professor Lee, you're a star for going through that. I'll make sure that I'm stronger in the future. Thank you so much. I also want to thank you sincerely for facilitating the opportunity for me to be here from Jamaica. It means so much. And I feel like all of us can say we are where we are because others lifted as they climbed. And so to have the opportunity to do the same is priceless. So thank you so much. And to be in the company of these distinguished women. Okay, so where do we, I wanted to start with the question of how did I find my passion and my path? And just like the ladies in Hidden Figures, which is the best thing to have ever happened to me, I grew up wanting to be an astronaut. That was always my thing. And as a result, I wanted to be wherever did that and did that best. And so if that would have been in Siberia, that's where I would have applied to because I wanted to do wherever, you know, do this and do it wherever was best for that. And my parents were very encouraging of me and MIT came up a lot. And so I applied. And when I was applying, only one student would get into MIT every year from Jamaica. That was the known standard. And so you can imagine the kind of stress that I was under from December 31 to March 17. I remember the date. And then when I got in, and I was really stressed out too because there was a set of twins who had applied and their older brother had gone to MIT. And when you have family, you know, it makes a difference. I thought there, oh my gosh, I don't know if this is gonna work, but it did and I was over the moon. So I got here and I'm bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. Like you, I also did a British-based high school system. And even just the speed at which people spoke was difficult for me because I, you know, that's not how people speak at home. T's had become D's and it was a hot mess, you know? And so there was a lot to get through in that process to adjust. But as has been stated, it was other people who really helped pull me through. Do they still have the red flag philosophy 6 weeks into your first? Okay. So I got my red flag and I thought the world is ending. I had never gotten anything. All my flags before were green, right? I had never gotten anything like this. And I remember a friend said to me, Ayanna, are you working in groups, you know, or are you attempting problem sets by yourself? And I'm like, groups? I'm not working in groups because back at home, you did that if you weren't competent. If you were competent, you did something on your own and you only would turn to somebody else if you just couldn't figure something out. So it almost was like cheating, you know? And for me, that there was no glory in that. You don't do that. So I really had a paradigm shift when she said to me, no, the professors assume that you're going to have discussions together, map out a path, and then, you know, get to the rest of it by yourself. And I'm like, are you serious? That would have made a big difference. And that really, really helped to turn the corner, you know? So here I was going through, when I got into course 16, I was the only black person and, of course, therefore the only black woman. And so I remember there being a lot on my shoulder at the time. You know, I was a woman, international, black, you know, there was so much going on. And I think one of the things that led to that I want to encourage you not to do is that I overanalyzed a lot of things. So if something came up in class and I wanted to ask a question, I would analyze what I wanted to say for so long that the moment would pass, because I felt like I was representing my gender and my country, and there was so much going on with that. And as I prepared to speak to you, I wanted to remind you that though that may be true, though you may be the only one from your family to have ever gone to university, much less an elite one, or the only one from your community, or in my case, my country for that year, don't carry all of that on your shoulder every day, because it will be too much to handle. You still have to live for only you. You know, when I say that, I don't mean you don't care about others, but I mean in the day-to-day approach to life, you can't carry mommy and daddy and everybody on your shoulders, because you will end up in paralysis analysis. You still have to say, how can I as an individual make the best of things, allowing myself to fail, knowing that there will be lessons in that process. So that really helped me in the process of making things through, and I want to encourage you to do the same thing. So as I continued along, I realized that a lot of astronauts have their areas of specialty. And if a mission is happening that requires those specialties, then they're asked to be a part of it, you know? And so I said to myself, okay, I really want to find out what my niche area would be, and allowed myself to, you know, say, okay, if there were, shall we say, no remuneration for this effort, if this was something that I just would wake up and do just because I'm passionate about it, what would that thing be for me? And literally, I know it sounds cliche, but I was walking by a lecture hall and there was a lecture that had happened and they still had the booklet from the session, and they were speaking about satellite communication technologies and how disruptive that technology can be to bring access to basic human rights for people, especially those, of course, at the lowest ends of the socioeconomic ladder. And I got very excited about that, because for me, that brought together things that meant so much to me: aerospace engineering and then developing economies and being able to use this technology for the upliftment of those things. And I thought, oh my gosh, yes, this is it. This is what I want to do, because I didn't want to be a part of a program, let's say a space program, where I didn't call the shots, where at the time, George W. Bush was the president, and his effort was just to prove that the U.S. could get to Mars before anybody else, but just for bragging rights, you know? And I feel like we have one lap around the track of life, and I want it to be very meaningful. I want to be 85, kicking it with my O2 girls and my other girls, and feel like I really made a difference. The world is a better place because I was here. And I didn't have that guarantee in that reality, but using technologies for social good provided that. So that was a passion. And like many people are saying, I was a lone wolf in that space, you know, because in my department, a lot of the attention, as you can imagine, was on making tools, even some of them warfare tools, to forward the agenda of defense and other such mechanisms. So using these technologies for socioeconomic development was a different story. But as has been said, your story is your story. Nobody else needs to validate that. And in truth, since there'll never be anybody else like you on the planet, and there never has been, it actually makes sense that your path can be individual. I know it can be scary, and I think personalities that are drawn to MIT love an agenda. This step leads to this step leads to this step leads to this step. We love that. And when you get into a space where you're writing your own rules and you don't know what comes next, it's scary. But it's okay. Another thing I learned too is that life is more art than science, which is scary for us engineering or just MIT types. And that's okay too. So for me, what I used to do, even just in managing life, I'd be like, okay, I have to get somewhere for 3 o'clock. I'll start getting ready at 2:43 because it takes me 4 minutes to shower, and then it takes me, and that's crazy, right? Because if the phone rings or if there's something wrong with the pipe, it's a hot mess, or if you get stopped on the road. So that has, so develop a comfort with the fact that life is more art than science, but there is a space for our types within that, notwithstanding, for the balance and the yin and yang. And so just always ask yourself, what is the lesson I can take from this in evolving and moving forward? You're always finding your passion. You're always fine-tuning that. And that's why we get up and continue to move at life. I think if everything were perfect and the equilibrium was, you know, perfectly stated in this fashion, why would we continue to push? Where would be that fire in the belly to continue to make things better? So we need to develop a comfort level with being uncomfortable. And the passion in life, I find, really comes outside of our comfort zone. So if it feels weird, if you feel a little scared, it probably means you're doing the right thing, and just continue to get advice and move forward in faith. And so one of the things that really made a difference for me as I did this was having mentors who I could lean on to tell them what the problems were, be they financial, be they with regard to academics. And I can't underscore enough the power of a mentor. I challenge anyone in this room to say they made it to where they are right now without any mentors. Make sure that you are not afraid to ask, that you continually get this, you know, feedback, and you identify people at different stages. And mentors also may come to a point where they can't take you any further. So sometimes you also have to say, okay, I feel like you've played your role, but right now the comments are making me feel like there's a box around me and you may need to expand beyond that. And that is okay too. And so moving on from this, there are non-traditional and difficult choices that you can imagine had to be made. And one of the things that really helped me with this, there's a fellow alum called Dr. Randall Pinkett, and he gave a talk when I was in my senior year talking about the road less traveled. And he said there are always two paths in life. There's a path that's very well traveled, the Goldman Sachs folks, you know, they know where the pitfalls are, you know, the markers of success. And then there's the other path where you're going to have to get a machete, you can't even see the street, and you're like working your way through, right? And of course, what I've learned about parents is parents love us, right? They don't want anything to happen to us. So they may sometimes lean towards the path already trod because they know that that's a safer path. And so there's some times that you may have to be orthogonal to their advice because you know that there is, shall we say, a lap of life where your parents have had a baton and then they've passed the baton to us, and it's our duty to go further with that baton. And that may cause them to have some fear, and that is not necessarily a bad thing either. Of course, it's a balance, right? Because they also have experience that we don't yet have. But it's important to realize that sometimes we'll have to push the envelope further than they were able to get to it in life. So I encourage us to think about the path that has not yet been trod. And the real question is, if not us, then who? You know, we are at the world's leading, well, I'm no longer here. Whoa, I didn't think I realized that. We're here now. Thank you, yeah. We are at the world's leading engineering university. And I feel like to whom much is given, much is expected. And so we shouldn't allow others to sort of seek permission to have a voice. We are the ones who will move things further. We are the ones who history should... The history has a special place reserved for the brave and those who are willing to take risks, and those should be us. And I always say to people, if this is not the time to take risks, when I think the majority of us might not yet have had children, we're responsible primarily for ourselves, or even if we're responsible for our parents, there isn't a day-to-day, I need to change their diaper kind of reality, you know? This is the time to go out there and take educated risks and pursue your passions and get that machete and really leave your mark. And so I want to encourage you to always remember that. In terms of tensions I experienced at MIT, this will have to be the Cliff Notes version because we can talk about this. So even when I first got to this country, I remember I was at JFK and my bags had not come in. And the immigration officer, upon their arrival, said he'd have to go through them one-on-one.
And he looked very excited because he knew he had found two drug pushers from Jamaica. It was myself and my mother. And so he looked really excited as he was putting on his gloves, because I don't know, maybe he gets a promotion for every packet of drugs he finds. And so he's going through my suitcase and he comes upon an orientation booklet for MIT. And I promise you, the color drains from his face. He looks really, really concerned for me. And he says, MIT is really hard, you know, why didn't you apply to a state school in New York? But it wasn't a rhetorical question. He wanted to save me the, you know, inevitable embarrassment of driving up north and going to Boston, where I would, you know, indubitably fail. And I realized in that moment, especially for my, you know, African-American sisters and brothers, what it must be like to grow up in this environment. Because I can imagine how many other people who look like us don't even apply to MIT. Because when they go into that office, the guidance counselor is like, what? I know we've spoken about that, Eileen. The guidance counselors are like, no, this is like, yeah, what you need to not be doing. And so I want us to be a part of the change, to change that dialogue, because it's still happening, and to do these kinds of talks. It's great to talk at the university level, but kindergarten, the four-year-olds, the five-year-olds, that's where we need to unlock the potential and let them know how possible it is. Especially even just as girls, sometimes we are not made to feel like the, you know, the technical pursuits are for us. Even when we look at the toys that we're given, you know, the little play stove and the dolls and the comb to comb their hair, etc., that really sends a message about what the roles are. Whereas with our boys, we may give them Legos that fit into certain pieces and cars that go quickly, that helps with their hand-eye coordination. And I remember when I was at MIT, Larry Summers had said, he was the past Harvard president, that he really thinks boys are better at math than girls are, because his boys play with trucks and his girls play with dolls. Who bought them that? Did they walk into Target? No, they did not. And that affects what they think they can do. So take ownership of the role you play in inculcating the young and what their perceptions may be. So that experience at JFK really primed me. And then upon getting into the aerospace department, there were so many times I'd be in meetings and I'd make a point. And of course, it isn't listened to by my white male colleagues. And then 3 hours later, another white male colleague would make the same point. But that's a great idea. That's what we should do.
Fantastic.
And I'm like, 3 hours ago, I said that, you know? So you realize that you always have to be on point. There's no small task. You always have to come correct, because unfortunately, the assumption from the get-go may be that you don't have it right, and so you have to be the one to prove that, no, you got that wrong, and it's together. I'll end in terms of tensions at MIT with a story from, this is now year six, right? I'm in the aerospace department as a graduate student, and a janitorial staff member came up to me and she was like, thank you so much for yesterday. And I said to her, what are you talking about? She said, you're the new janitor, right? And you picked up the garbage bag from the classroom. And I said, no, I'm not a janitor. I go to school here. And she looked at me very, very concerned, like, my God, she just started working here and she's already hallucinating that she's a student. She looked really worried for me, like, I don't think her job is going to last a long time. And she walked off without any contrition, you know, just, I guess, in her mind, really hoping that I make it given my hallucinating problems. In terms of my discipline now and the tensions I've faced there, much like Breagin, I've really found an old boys' club. And in my meetings, I am the only person under 50, and I'm the only person who is a woman. I'm not the only person who is black, but when I travel, then that is added to it. And I've also found that even in terms of being petite, there can be discrimination against that too, because if you're just 5'1 and you're a little person, maybe they think we have smaller brains and it'll work as well. So there are lots of things that come together. But the most important thing is for you to wear is confidence, and to know that you've earned your place, to know that for us to get to where we are today, we had to work 15 times as hard, and always remind yourself of that. And even just remind yourself of the shoulders upon which we stand. You know, Professor Wesley Harris was one of my foundational people in Core 16, and I remember him speaking about the fact that when he was in university, there are only certain majors he could choose because he was black. And I was like, what? So your passion could have been chemistry and you just couldn't do chemistry just because you're black. And when I heard that, it inspired me to remember that in the darkest of moments, I stand on the shoulders of so many who, for whom I am their dreams personified. And I can do more than I would ever imagine, which MIT taught me. It taught me that the elastic band of possibility can always be stretched. Every semester when I looked at the curriculum of my different classes, I'm like, no way. This is not going to happen. And then, you know, a few all-nighters later, you're at the end of the semester, and it did. So just know that you always are able to do more than you think, which is something I've also picked up from bodybuilding in terms of strength and remembering that. As you can see, all our paths are circuitous. I always say, be firm on your objective, but flexible on your path. Always remember that. And when things don't go right along the path, just fail quickly, ask yourself what are the lessons and move on. It is never going to go exactly as planned. And I'm using never intentionally. It doesn't mean anything is going wrong. Our personalities love plans. I do too. But it's okay for things to vary from that. And then lastly, in terms of what allows me to continue to embrace challenges and opportunities, I always remember that you don't want to stay comfortable. You always want to stay hungry. There's always more we can learn. I think about Michelle. I think about Oprah. My level of the bar that I'm comparing myself to is incredibly high. Always keep that high. Always keep hungry. And always remember, as we said earlier, that what you want is at the outside of your comfort zone, whether you want to lose weight, whether you want to extend your career, learn a new language. Just tell yourself that you will be able to persevere through outside the comfort zone, and then your comfort zone becomes extended in having made that decision. So I am very happy to be able to be here with you. We're open for questions after, and thank you for your time.
When I came in 1995 to MIT, I think Paula was one of the first friends I made.
Oh.
And she is so busy that it's really an act of generosity for her to agree to talk to us today. So grateful. So, Professor Paula Hammond, MIT SB in Chemical Engineering, 84, Georgia Tech, MS in Chemical Engineering, 88, and PhD. Chemical Engineering, MIT in 93, is the David H. Koch Chair, Professor of Engineering at MIT, and the head of the Department of Chemical Engineering. She's a member of MIT's Koch Institute for Integrative Cancer Research, the MIT Energy Initiative, and a founding member of the MIT Institute for Soldier Nanotechnology. She recently served as the Executive Officer and Associate Chair of the Chemical Engineering Department, from 2008 to 2011. Now, this is going to be challenging for me, like Ayanna's was. The core is dense with accomplishments. So, the core of her work is the use of electrostatics and other complementary interactions to generate functional materials with highly controlled architecture. Her research in nanotechnology encompasses the development of new biomaterials to enable drug delivery from surfaces with spatiotemporal control. She also investigates novel responsive polymer architectures for targeted nanoparticle drug and gene delivery and self-assembled material systems for electrochemical energy devices. She was elected into the National Academy of Medicine in 2016 and into the 2013 class of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. She's also the recipient of the 2013 AI CHE, Chemical Engineering, Charles M. A. Stein Award, which is bestowed annually to a leading researcher in recognition of outstanding contributions to the field of material science and engineering, and the 2014 Alpha Chi Sigma Award for Chemical Engineering Research. She was selected to receive the Department of Defense Ovarian Cancer Teal Innovator Award in 2013, which supports a single visionary individual from any field principally outside of ovarian cancer to focus his or her creativity, innovation, and leadership on ovarian cancer research. During her sabbatical in 2013, she was a visiting scientist at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute and a visiting professor at the Nanyang Technological University in Singapore in the Chemical Engineering Department. Professor Hammond continues to serve as an associate editor of the American Chemical Society Journal, ACS Nano. As a part of the Year of Chemistry in 2011, she was one of the top 100 material scientists named by Thomson Reuters, a recognition of the highest citation impact in the field over the past decade, from 2001 to 2011. She's published over 200 papers and holds over 20 patents based on her research at MIT. She was named a fellow of the American Physical Society, the American Institute of Biological and Medical Engineers, and the American Chemical Society Polymer Division. Professor Hammond's work on multi-layer tattoos for transdermal DNA vaccines was recently featured on the PBS NOVA program Making Stuff with David Pogue, and she was also featured in the Chemical Heritage Foundation's Catalyst series, Women in Chemistry. Thanks so much.
Now I know I really need to edit that bio. I'm really happy to be here. As Helen said, we've been friends since the first moment we stepped on campus as faculty, in fact. Wow. For me, it's a special treat because life has become so entangled that it's difficult for me to make my way here to events like this. So for me, this is really special because I've missed being able to be in touch with the rest of the Black women on campus. So I'm going to tell you, and Helen laid out some of the things to talk about. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what got me here, what got me through here, and also some of the things I learned from that. So basically, my passion when I was younger, when I was in middle and beginning of high school, was originally to write children's fiction. And I was certain I was going to do that and be, you know, the next, I don't know, Black Judy Blume or something like that, until I got to chemistry class. And it was in that chemistry class that I had my first chance to do an experiment in a lab. And I was able to mix chemicals together and see them change color, create heat, create bubbles, all that stuff. That got me excited. And I spent more and more time helping clean up after chemistry lab. And the chemistry teacher, who was a woman, said, you should think about chemical engineering. Now, she didn't say chemistry, because this was the mid-80s. This was a time when engineering was really at the forefront. And so I thought, okay, what is chemical engineering? She gave me a start on that, and then I went back and investigated that with the help of my parents. So by the time I was a senior, that was my junior year, by the time I was a senior, I was sure I wanted to go chemical engineering. And like Ayanna said, I wanted to go to the best place. I wanted to dig right in. So I decided to go to MIT. When I visited MIT before I came here, I was amazed. I thought, this place, it's me. Because I was the kid in school who was not hip. And I grew up in Detroit, Michigan. And folks are hip in Detroit, Michigan. They dress and the hair. I mean, you know what I'm saying. So I was the not as hip kid who was reading a lot and, you know, always answering questions in class, but I kind of was not a fit. So I felt like I really fit when I got here on campus. So that was my first impression, was, oh my God, I have to come here. These are my people, this is it. Exactly. When I started here, though, I became terrified because I began to realize that I went to an all-girls Catholic school in Detroit. Calculus was not an emphasis, you know. In fact, I was the only one who went to a technical school out of my year, and I didn't feel as prepared mathematically. I had taken fairly minimal physics, and I was looking around at what everyone else could do and thinking, huh, uh-oh, you know. So I quickly shifted from these are my people to a sense that I was not quite there yet. Mm-hmm. And maybe they made a mistake. I think I even asked the person who was chair of admissions at that time, you know, I asked the Neil Armstrong, you know, are you sure there was not a mistake, you know? And he laughed, but I was trying to assess, how did I get in here and what am I going to do now? I did, because of fear, dig in, you know, but sometimes fear is a good thing. Use your fear. You know, sometimes when you walk into scary situations, and you're trying to assess, you determine, okay, I'm here, I've got to do something, so let me figure out how to survive. And then what got me through MIT was how warm and welcoming the community was, in particular the Black community. I mean, it was as soon as you land on campus, you're part of the Black community. You become one. Mm-hmm. And we would march up and down together as freshmen, all together in the same class. We knew exactly how many Black freshmen there were. You know, it was one of those things. You were a class within the class.
Right.
So that got me through, because there were upperclassmen, and I was hooked up, you know, to find out the other chemical engineering students. There were juniors and seniors that I revered because they made it through thermodynamics. You know, let's show me how you did this. There were several touch points that those experiences gave me that let me know that I can survive here. So when I began to approach my senior year, I got enough confidence to know that I can swim in the water and still breathe. Mm-hmm. And that's important. I felt like I had some grounding. And I thought, okay, now that I feel like I can swim, maybe I can learn a few strokes. I started to look around and see what really interested me. And in chemical engineering, we kind of barrage you with a lot of things that don't involve chemicals at all for the first 2 years of training. It's as if the chemicals go away for a while, and there's just, you know, flow fields and, you know, vapors and things of this nature. So I was missing my chemicals, and I took a class that was taught by a now-retired professor, Ed Merrill, who just made polymer chemistry come alive. It was an elective class, but it just caught me. I thought, you can make stuff, and you can create these materials that are actually going to be able to do something. So that really lit me up. I got excited. But when I was graduating, I was also young. I think Breagin had mentioned this whole, I think a number of us have this experience of coming here and coming here kind of young. I was graduating. I was 20 years old. I was engaged to another MIT engineer. And I wasn't sure. I felt like maybe I should consider grad school, but I didn't consider grad school. I decided to go for a job, get some money, get a job, get a normal life. So I went to Fort Lauderdale, Florida, where I worked for Motorola. My husband moved there with me, and we started this life together. Now, in that two-year period that I was at Motorola, I had my first process engineering job. And what is interesting is that I was a process engineer for this plant that packaged microelectronic devices that go into cell phones. Yeah, this is before cell phones were called cell phones, though. They were called cellular. Anyway, this was back in the day when it was like a little suitcase. Okay. But anyway, and what I realized when I got there was that I was one of five Black engineers in the plant, okay, and the plant had maybe about 400 engineers.
Wow.
And my husband was one of the other ones. And on top of that, all of the factory workers, because it was a manufacturing plant, were Black and Hispanic women. So I went into, you know, you put on those bunny suits to go into the clean room for the microelectronics packaging, and people were just talking to me like I was one of the, you know, manufactured workers, right? And it was just the strangest, bizarre, upside-down thing. It was because I was going in there to try and give direction, and people were coming to me to direct me, you know? Mm. It's like, you're lost, you know? Where's your station? But the thing that really got me was how different our worlds were, and the fact that there are all of these women at these machines, and I'm thinking how many of them could be engineers, and how many of them could be excelling. So it really had an impact on me. It also was an experience in which I learned that throughout your life, you will duel with people who have a problem with your presence.
Mm-hmm.
And in this particular case, when I came in, I got comments like, what's the big deal? So she's from MIT, she's so smart. but it really was about, what's this black woman coming in here in our environment and disrupting it like this? And I entered at the same time as a young white male engineer who became instantly popular, and we ended up getting very different assignments. And as he began to rise, I sort of stayed at neutral. And I did several things in my role, but when I came to my supervisor to talk about my promotion and what I need to do for it, he was like, well, you're going to have to do a lot. And I don't know. It was just this entire barrage of all the things that don't seem really up to par. And I couldn't really imagine anything that I'd done that wasn't beyond par. So I began to realize this is a situation where there's a real problem. That and the fact that there were women engineer jokes and there were all kinds of crude things that were happening around me. It was one of those negative environments where you just have to stand, do your job, and then work your workaround. And my thoughts were, I want to do something where I actually can make something. I went back to what I really wanted to do, which was to work with polymers and materials and to engage in this process of using chemistry to do something exciting. So after 2 years, we left. We moved to Atlanta for 2 years when I was at Georgia Tech. I worked for the Georgia Tech Research Institute and got a master's at the same time. Mm-hmm. And although that was a lot of work, I was thrilled. I was extremely happy. It was as if I had been released back into a world in which I could do what I wanted to do. I was speaking and working with people who respected me, and that was just incredible. But it also taught me that I wanted to be back on a campus. I wanted to be with other students. I wanted to engage in working with fellow students or faculty and creating things. And the idea that you could actually think up an idea, and if you can convince someone to fund it, you can do it, you can guide others to do it, that really got me excited. So I knew at that moment I wanted to go back to academia. And I heard there was a program at MIT that brought me back here in polymer science in the chemical engineering department, and I got my PhD. The difference in being at MIT the first time and the second time was stark. I came back to MIT as someone who had worked out in the world, knew what I wanted to do, knew what I wanted to get, and I had lost the illusion that my classmates, my white male classmates, were somehow smarter than me. And I think I had held that illusion for a large part of my undergraduate experience. Mm-hmm. But I came back was, yeah, right, let me help you, things had changed, and I felt, I began to understand that this was something that was, a part of our environment, but was not something I had to accept. At that point, I really got some help from mentors, and I think we talked about mentors a little bit. My mentors as a graduate student were actually the members of my thesis committee. I chose a thesis advisor who was caring and supportive and understood the balance of family and life. I had my son when I was a graduate student. I learned about resourcing. My sister-in-law moved up magically after the birth of of my child and helped, and there were all kinds of innovative ways to manage that process and that experience. I went through, in terms of life in parallel and sort of managing those things, I went through a separation and divorce and remarriage, and during this process was becoming a junior faculty member at MIT. So I learned how to be a single mom. And me and Helen really bonded when we first met about some of these issues, but being a single mom and also following your dream. And I learned about how to gain the support that you need from your environment and to really use that support. In terms of one of the things I was asked was whether my identity or my path either came at odds with what I chose to do. And I think what I find is that as a faculty member at MIT, I love my fellow faculty members. I love MIT. But one of the things that I think I constantly end up talking about with my colleagues is the fact that diversity and excellence are complementary, that they help each other. And it's funny because I've just had an experience with, I'm a department head now, and we're talking about putting together our diversity strategic plan. And there are, I will say one thing, there are some faculty who have come to me even before I brought this up and said, I want to help, I want to do something. I am so encouraged by them. There are other faculty who are my colleagues and my friends, and they're saying, we don't need a plan. All you need to do is look for excellent people and things just happen. And like, what have you done without a plan that has worked? It's hard to get them, it's hard to get some of our colleagues to understand, first of all, that these two things go together, and second of all, that you have to take action. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I found again and again. So it's sort of like that story that you have to say, repeat multiple times, that by expanding the people, the breadth of knowledge that you get is huge. The benefits that you get are huge. The number of perspectives that you bring to a problem are huge. And for us, we bring value to a problem simply from the different perspectives and the way that we approach the problem. And having that depth is so incredibly important and so incredibly successful. So I find that I sometimes have to go through that story, and explain that this is an important effort. What I also find interesting and is about my dear MIT, is that because we believe in a meritocracy, sometimes there are faculty who think that harder equals better. And again, these are conflated, right? Concepts, right? I remember talking to a colleague just very recently about the fact that I think that we get fewer women and minority applicants because I said something like a number of people are saying how hard it is to be a faculty member at MIT. Well, that should encourage them to apply more. They're really selective. That means we're the top because I'm like, no. Selective is one thing. No, I'm saying that there's an idea that there's not mentoring, that there's not support for people coming in, and that is discouraging. And he's like, no, he could not separate the idea that that support for excellent people is different from choosing only the excellent ones. You want to bring people in that you think are going to be outstanding contributors and then support them. And I think this whole idea that it has to be some sort of difficult path and that's what makes it good has to be eliminated. And Somewhere it's still in the edges and the corners of different areas of MIT, sometimes it's right in the front, but we have to work on that. I think we have become better. I can definitely say that, but we do have to work on that. Finally, some advice. One of them I've learned is that patience can be an incredible tool. I find that if I listen to my colleagues and my cohorts, try to understand where their perspective and their fears and their concerns are coming from, if I can hear all of it, I can then address it and bring them to a different place. And that provides a number of teaching moments. Another piece of advice is to assess your needs and then seek a way to fulfill them. And I know this sounds obvious, but as women tend to do a lot. We multitask. We do 3, 4, 5, 6, and 18 things. And while we're doing those things, we put high expectations on ourselves. And we don't always stop to think about, why is this hard? Sometimes when you're going through difficult times, it's a good idea to stop and think, okay, this is a lot right now. What can I do to make this an easier path? Are there people who can help? Is there a plan that can change an element of my life that will improve my ability to do what I'm trying to do? Or do I need to adjust my list of things that I'm trying to do. I think that sometimes we don't openly admit that we need help doing something. And if we don't do that, then we can't see what we need that can help us get through to the other side, which might be calling your sister-in-law and asking them to move, or other things that can actually make a huge difference in your life. Finally, I'd like to remind you of how impressive you are. One of the things that amazes me is just the range of women that we have here, the strong black women. And I feel like I've had an opportunity to engage with generation after generation. We mentioned Princess. She's one of my academic advisees. Deborah Gust. There's a list. I can't even go through the list. But it's just amazing to see what you're doing and how strong and heartfelt you are about what you're doing and how passionate you are. So whenever you feel like there's a lot in front of you or you're facing a significant burden, think about who you are and how impressive you are. And stop and pat yourself on the back. Celebrate yourself. Because this is something that is important for us to do, is to celebrate ourselves, recognize what a gift we are to the world, and to appreciate that. Thank you.
Because life is more art than science, as Ayanna said, I have forgotten to thank the two people who work with me in Women's and Gender Studies, Emily Neal, who's the program manager.
Sophia, she had to go run the yoga class.
Okay, Sophia Hassifer. So they make everything happen, from the food to the sending out the notice of the event to the travel arrangements for the panelists, and they make my office happen too. So thank you so much. Secondly, I wondered if we could just take 5 minutes to go around the room and have everybody say, we have a lot of alumni, say your name and your year you graduated, and if you work here, then what your role is at MIT, just real quickly, so
this is a nice idea.
We have a way to connect.
Yeah.
Hi, Tabora Jones, class 2000. I'm currently in D.C., and that's why I'm about to run and get on the phone, because I work for the government. Yay!
come back after.
Hi, I'm Ananai Morgan. I'm in the Resource Development Office. I'm not one of the smart, incredible people around you. I'm just in awe of all that you guys are doing.
I'm sure you're smart and incredible.
I'm sure you're fabulous.
I'm sure you are.
Did we not just hear we're celebrating ourselves?
Oh, yes, exactly.
There we go.
Hi, I'm Vinlai Chitipunye. I also work in the Office of Resource Development, and I'm awesome too, so glad to be here.
Nice.
Hi, I'm Adedoy, and I'm a freshman here.
Oh.
Hi, I'm Jordan. I'm also a freshman here.
Hi, I'm Mia, and I'm also a freshman.
All right.
Lovely.
I'm Shanice Hudson. I'm class of 2000.
I'm Roel. I'm a senior.
I'm Naomi. I'm a freshman.
Alyssa Joseph, program manager of multicultural programs.
I'm Aida. Been here 100 years. Actually, I'm one of the ones that's heading out of the door in retirement and into my other life that I imagine. And I'm also the housemaster of Eastgate, so I'll be here until June. Everybody knows me, they talk to me, so that's what my role is.
Love you. That's awesome.
Yay,
congratulations.
Love you.
I'm Saffron, I'm a freshman.
I'm Alexa, I'm a senior, so I'm on my way out.
I'm Grace, class of 2016.
I'm Louisa, I'm also a senior here, and I'm secretary of the Black Women's Alliance.
I'm in Canaan, class of 2002.
Oh, two?
Faven, I'm a senior. Count one today. Gialinda Branch, Office of Minority Education.
Liz Howard, Community Director of Multicultural Program.
My name is Deidre Ridley, class of 1982, electrical engineering, and affluent from San Jose.
Career specialist in global education and career development.
Chantal Cassio, class of 2018, so one more time here.
Can I ask if when our panelists are answering questions, if you could repeat the questions so that we can capture it?
Okay, because we're going to post this little film like we did last year. Okay, any questions?
I have a question for Ayanna. What made you decide to go back to Jamaica?
Excellent question. Thank you.
How did you know it was time to go back to Jamaica?
Excellent. Thank you. Okay. All right. So what I found out in my trips to Jamaica whilst I was still a student is that there was an interesting gap between the potential I saw and the resources available to capitalize on the potential. And one of the things I'll always be grateful for MIT for is that I never felt there had to be a secret sauce. People saw a problem and they rolled up their sleeves and they just got to solving them. And I realized that, wow, it really is just about your seeking to come up with a solution and finding out how the thing, seeing that gap between what you may have and what you need, and then seeing who you may need to speak to get that solved. And, you know, sometimes a half-baked pie is better than nothing. Don't wait until everything is perfect. Just get going and build momentum, and things will grow after that. And that really inspired me because Jamaica is much more British-like in terms of bureaucracy, and these steps need to happen first before we can execute on a project. And I thought to myself, no, I really want to be able to be in a space where I can make an impact through just beginning and getting started with the resources that I have and, of course, seeking help where that's needed. But one of the things that really, really touched me was that I felt that I could be a bridge between the international resources I had amassed and the potential that I saw at home that needed to be unlocked. And whenever I would attend development conferences looking at how information and communication technologies, satellite communication technologies can play a role in development, the Caribbean never came up. And so there would be Singapore, there'd be a lot of Asian countries, but I think because Jamaica has sold itself as sand and sea, people don't necessarily consider it as being in need of developmental assistance. And I thought to myself, the reason why the other countries are coming up is because their people ensured that their agenda bubbled to the surface. And I felt that I needed to be that person for Jamaica. I felt very strongly about that, you know? And I said to myself, well, I don't know if this is going to work, but I want, again, when I'm rocking in my chair at 90, to say I gave it a chance and I did it my way. And I said to myself, if I don't give this a try, no, I don't see when in the future would be a better time to give it a try. You know what I mean? And so with everything that I had been afforded, and I felt I had been afforded so much, as you've said, we really are blessed beyond measure in the opportunities we've been afforded. And I remember I attended a Harvard commencement talk where they spoke about an ovarian lottery. And the idea is really phenomenal. At the end of the day, we don't choose our parents and we don't choose our circumstances. So it is as if when we were born, there was an ovarian lottery, and the result of the lottery are the opportunities you've been afforded. And for all of us, those opportunities have afforded us being at MIT or us working at MIT. And with over 200 countries in the world, and with this being the best engineering university in the world, that's a big deal. And we ought to let that soak in, as you said, you know? And so I thought to myself, no, I feel like I'm best primed to make that difference, you know? And having left Jamaica, I fell more in love with Jamaica. All my friends would tell you that. It's all they heard ad nauseum. And I really felt so passionate about being a part of the change I wanted to see and allowing my people to realize how much potential there is for us to embed our state through working on various solutions. And so that made me feel like, you know, I don't necessarily have a job I'm going to return to. I'm going to have to just make it up as I go. But that will be okay, and I'll continue to have mentors that I speak to and really just try to make the best of it as I go, even though there were not and still are not, shall we say, established indicators of success, you know, which can be difficult if you are the kind of personality that would easily like that spread out, you know. But like most things in life, it doesn't necessarily come easy. And as we've said, you define your own rules, and there are times when you make mistakes, which is fine. And you know that, you know, look, I'm more evolved for it and wiser for it. So let me just try and make sure it doesn't happen again in the exact same way. And so far, so good. So, yeah, thank you.
In listening to you, this is a weird question, and I don't mean it as, I'm not exactly sure how to frame it. For the last couple of years, I've been paying a lot of attention to our role, meaning people of color, particularly black women, in a place like MIT. And I've been realizing that it's time for us to step up to the plate and tell particularly white people to talk to their families and teach their families progressive ways of dealing with things and help them to develop an agenda to help their relatives stop being who they are. Because it's ridiculous. It's almost 400 years and we're still hearing the same
rhetoric.
Huh?
Oh, I was just saying rhetoric, the same rhetoric.
The same, you know, nobody questions that people get mad at their families and they abandon their families, but they don't take them on. And so, It to me indicates that we're at a time now where, like what Paula was talking about, and you see these backward things that are coming out of people's mouths, and you know they're in trouble, and you know they're in pain, but they don't know how to deal with their family, so they come over to us. And if we let this happen, it'll be another 100 years, and there'll still be white rhetoric that is completely annoying, you know, as you were saying, about how it feels to be, what it must feel like to be a part of the U.S. system, and what it feels like to be black in America. So it might be that we're really facing a time in which we're going to have to come step up to the plate on leadership and race, because nobody else will do it. And I think each of you said something in your talk that indicated that, actually. I don't know if you know it, but it was there. Just like I went to the Hidden Fences thing, and we... When I went to that, I said the same thing in the audience. I mean, I've never been in a situation where people not black could understand what was going on. It was so clear in the film, and I think we need to do that. Each of us in our roles need to find people to talk to, and then say to your white colleagues or your friends or whatever, I need you to step up to the plate. We'll help you to figure out what to read. We can't go to your house and dinner with your aunt who's 900 years old who says these horrible things all the time. It has to be something that we can help you to do. Mm-hmm. And then you can come back and say, this happened, and then we can talk about it. But if we don't do it, who will do it? Who is going to step up to the plate? And I thought that was a, whatever it is, hidden what?
Figure.
It has another part to the thing. Fabulous film. But it's, they did it to us for 3 years now. They've been ignoring us in these Academy Awards. And it's time to step up to the plate, to bring all of this. Paula, I met you through your first husband, who said, you don't really like my wife, which turned out to be true. You know, each of you, I've seen you in different situations. And I think that, I don't know if any of you want to speak to it, but I think even if it's a short little thing that you respond to, maybe this is one of the things that we should do. You know, talk to people about you know, what to do with white people. No, it's important.
Seriously.
Huh?
Seriously.
And it's not their fault. They don't have the leadership. We're the ones that can give them the leadership, actually.
Anybody want to address what
to
do?
So, sorry. I'm a youngin'. And we had a multicultural graduation celebration, and Jasmine Washington said that you guys are leaving a place of support with people of color, and you're going to go out there, and there's just going to be white people. And I was like, oh, it won't be that bad. But you see, what happens is And they're not, you know, they're well-meaning, but given the state of our country now, it's hard to be that voice and be that leader in the workplace when you're just trying to get work done. And there have been several moments where I felt like I was called upon to speak for the Black voice, and I said, all I want to do is make this online course. I don't really want to tell you how you're supposed to talk to your family about the mistakes that they made. You know, it's interesting that you say that we should be called upon it, but it's also when my supervisors are the ones who are, you know, like, I guess I have this question for the rest of the panel too. Like, what? How do you reconcile the fact that you're in a place of work and you're trying to get work done, and you can't do the exhausting business of trying to school them in how not to be racist, or even just how, you know, how to check themselves in unconscious bias?
So I can't solve that one, but I can tell you that it is an undercurrent in my scholarship. So. This is Breagin again, and the sort of question is, how do you get people to talk about race and their evil ways? Mm-hmm. I'll just, does that sound reasonable? Okay, so so this is one of the undercurrents in my scholarship. So I look at how your beliefs about economic success shape the way you allocate money, right? But what that means is I can freely, within the construct of beliefs about economic success, ask you, someone on Amazon MTurk, which is about 80% white, lower working class American, pretty much populated by that group, I can say things like, oh, imagine that there is a Black employee who is your same age but who is your boss, as a way of priming the idea that maybe this person doesn't belong there. And then I can, you know, I can look at how they behave differently, right? And so that's one of the things I do. So within my scholarship, I do very, as traditional as an interdisciplinary person can be, I do very traditional things. I use, you know, standard manipulations. But there's always that one study, it's usually study four, where I throw a race manipulation in, or I throw a gender manipulation in, right? Female boss, anybody? Person who doesn't speak English, like, welcome to America, speak English. Well, that's actually kind of a crappy assumption to make, but let me leverage the fact that you make that assumption. And then I can show that you behave the same ways when you're challenged. But then in the discussion section, I can say things like, it turns out that this situation is a parallel to what we saw in, for example, I live in Syracuse, New York, when the corporations actually farmed out factory jobs to the South for cheaper labor. Now, all of a sudden, all of these white employees are being replaced with cheaper Black employees. And now I can begin to talk a little bit about these kinds of things. But it's hard. And the one thing my advisor, who was loving and caring and very compassionate, told me the day I said this to him, he said, Breagin, you don't want to be the Black girl who studies Black people. And there's a certain truth to that. Although my response was, but all these white people are the white dude who studies white men. I had a professor who, I kid you not, I had a professor who went to like the first Burning Man and was like, I'm gonna make this an ethnography. You know that man got a chair for hanging out with his friends and writing about it, right? So I try very hard to bring my friends into my work and to sort of have these discussions, but it is really, really hard. Like, think about the last time somebody checked you. It was hard, right? And you might have actually pushed back a little bit, but over time, you become to see yourself in a mirror, and that's what I try to do, but there are small mirrors at this point, and so to the extent that I can do that in my work, I do, which is kind of the best I can give right now. I have a multicultural, multiracial family, so we have these discussions, but it's hard, right? My next door neighbor, I love her to bits and pieces. She was one of the first doctors in the state of New York. I roll up at the HOA meeting, my first one. I was probably like 27, 28. And she goes, "Man, that's a pretty little colored girl." And all my white neighbors were like, we don't call them colored anymore. we call them black." And she turned red, right? I didn't have to correct her. I just needed to empower the other people around me to say something, right? I just looked like one eyebrow up, which I can barely do, right? So very small expression, but that is enough sometimes. You know, make your faces. See what happens.
There are lots of different ways to do racial and social justice work, and you
yeah.
sort of find lots of ways within the sphere, you know, to do that. It's not one way. It's all
right.
Yeah. Oh no, go ahead. Okay, thanks. I'll be short. I really like that addition, because given that it is different ways, you can choose a way that's most comfortable for you. But I can tell you, your sheer existence is a big message too.
It is.
And you're not walking around with your head down, but acting like you exist, having a place. If people make an assumption where they say, "Okay, we hope everybody's wife will be okay with this," you're like, "No, I don't have a wife. You know, I have a, there are women who work here." Like, you know, really just knowing that standing in your authenticity is a message. So if people assume that everybody's going to have fun by going to the bar and getting drunk, but you know that having fun for you is going to a play and or going to a museum, and you're standing your ground and saying, "Actually, no, I really wanted to see this play. There's a Cuban writer who's coming here," and that's also standing in your truth. And yes, it is hard, but the moment we were given birth to as little black girls, we already entered into a contract that wasn't going to be easy. And I haven't figured out a way to get back from where I came, so it's already an obligation that we have by being here. And we have gone through so much already to be where we are now. We can remember that and have that be a part of our fuel to be able to move forward. But there are different days, you're in different moods. And you can answer somebody through not answering and giving them the look to say, "Is that really a question? There's something we learned earlier." What was it? Obtuse. Is that an intentionally obtuse thought?
Obtuse?
You know, so there are different ways that you can work on it. But just know that for me, when we think about the fact that it's hard, the alternative may be harder. So not saying anything, allowing them to think that that's okay, you know, especially given that these are people that you spend 8 to 9, 10 hours with a day, is a harder alternative. And so if those are the two options we face, then we say to ourselves, in a way that works for you, let me try to continue to raise awareness and to share. And after you've shared your truth, if people don't understand or don't agree, that's their problem and not yours. You know, you don't have to continue to try to convince. You speak your truth and then you continue to work on your online course.
I love what Ayanna just said. So
thank you.
I won't add to that. I think I'll just comment on some things I've observed over the past few years. As a department head, I've seen younger faculty coming to me wanting to do something to help with diversity. And when we, so BSU put out the request for a strategy and a plan, and the department put together their list, I sent an email, here's what the proposed statement is and comments, and I got comments. I got several notes from faculty members saying, "Here's an idea, why don't we try this, why don't we try that?" That encouraged me. I'm thinking there's an undercurrent here. And I don't hear these voices all the time in formal meetings. But when I ask for this sort of individual exchange, I'm getting several people putting in. So I decided we'll have a faculty meeting. We'll sort through these ideas and invite others. And by trying to introduce a setting where people who are interested in expanding both the way that we think and where we can go with diversity will feel comfortable. And I think that's part of it, is that creating that comfort zone. And that's something that relies on leadership. We need for that to happen many, many, many times over again. But I think the more that we do, the more we encourage the people who will be positive doers in the end.
That's kind of how it worked in my department.
couple of us drafted something, and then there was a discussion and became a collaborative. Khalea, what did
No, absolutely. I agree. I think it's incredibly important, firstly, to notice that you, in and of yourself, are an ambassador. And I know that sometimes that feels like a weight and a burden, and we've all talked about that. But it's also a tremendous gift. And when you are the only young person, or only woman, or only Black person in the room, you know, think of the ancestors and realize, no, seriously, kind of the power that you hold in your presence and the power that your words have. And if you feel like a certain argument is being left out of a discussion, or certain facts are being misstated, correct them, you know, civilly, professionally, but make sure that everyone understands what the facts are. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, similarly, I think there are different forms of racism in media and in the workplace. Sometimes it's silencing, you know, those who are present. Sometimes it's also elevating or somehow kind of reinforcing a stereotype. So if there is a Black writer, a Black researcher who you think is really absolutely phenomenal, make sure that that name gets put forward. Mm-hmm. Make sure that you talk about their work. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes, and it could be just ignorance, it could be something else, I don't know. Sometimes the names that get advanced are not our strongest ones. So make sure.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Book world a lot.
Okay, yes, in publishing, yeah, absolutely.
Just judged a book prize and was appalled at watching that unfold.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's
a really good point.
I get this thing at work where they look at me, because I'm the only one. I actually send people to the website and I'm like, look for the hair. Because I'm the only one, right? So I show, I say this thing, they'll say, so do you have any suggestions or recommendations? And all my girlfriends know, I'm like, look, here's the list of 25 women. You are number 17. You will show up in the rotation for this, this, and this. Is there an opportunity that you would like? Let me know, right? It's a slightly modified version of a strategy called amplification, which if you've read Lean In, there's a really good sort of example of it where I say something and then you go, it's like Breagin said, right? So it's that sort of idea, right? Okay. If you make sure that the people around you know what you are trying to do so that they can, because they are often the only one or one of just a few in these very disparate rooms, mm-hmm. you end up having more social capital than you know. So make sure the people that you are connected with know what you are interested in, because they will be the bridges to the islands that you're trying to reach. Right, so you gotta stay with your girls, with people who support you. They might not, you know, look like you. They might not even be women in a lot of cases, and that's fine.
Insurance. Right? Mm-hmm.
Find your mentors and find your champions and find people who think that you are awesome and let them talk about you.
Yeah, absolutely. Amen.
Yeah.
Build alliances.
Absolutely.
Yes. And honor your alliances and check. Check the situations in you're in, not because someone is paying you means that if their value system doesn't match yours, that it's okay to stay. There, you know, remuneration has never and will never just be a paycheck. It also is about the value system. So ensure that it's aligned with yours. And if it isn't, you may be killing your spirit softly, and there's nothing someone can pay you to make up for that.
Right.
So be very prepared to say, no, thank you, this has been great, and do those checks and balances. Because sometimes you end up fighting more than you should, you know? And so be very aware of your right to that, too.
Yeah.
So, of course, you guys have all taken different paths to get to where you are today, but I'm just wondering, where do you all see yourselves in 10 years?
Freshman keeping it real.
No pressure.
So repeat the question.
Okay.
So the question is, acknowledging that we all had different paths to where we are currently on this panel, where do we see ourselves in 10 years?
where do I see myself in 10 weeks?
Good answer.
In 10 days, I expect to... I'm sorry, I have no idea about 10 years. I d- Does anyone know about 10 years? I feel like 10 years is a lot. Sorry? Oh, girl. So yes, one of my dreams is to build Negro Town, to build a school, you know, to be Secretary of Education. All of these are like lofty goals, but in terms of like, I don't, guys, do you?
Well, I have no idea.
No.
No, I mean, I think part of this discussion is like learning to, I think the takeaway is like keep yourself open to opportunities, right? Because it's not necessarily a straight line from where you are to where you're going. And if any of us were to look back 10 years ago, you know, I don't think we, well, I think Professor Hammond had a clear vision of where she wanted to go. But for the rest of us, I think so much changes and you just have to kind of be willing to see opportunities as they arise and seize on them. So stay prepared, but keep your options open, I think.
So one of the things that I'm working on, which hopefully will be done in 10 years, is I'm looking at predicting future demand for government services, things that we typically associate with a safety net. I'm particularly interested in this because of what my cousin calls the robot apocalypse. This is the idea that, you know, things like self-driving cars and massive online classes will, they've already replaced a lot of what we consider to be repetitious, unskilled labor. But, you know, what happens when they come for the jobs of the truck drivers and we recognize that shipping and truck driving is one of the top five employers in just about every state, right? What happens to our unemployment rate? What happens to people's sense of self-worth and self? And so that's what I'm interested in. It is incredibly depressing. I eat a lot of chocolate and I work out. And so like that's what I wanna do, right? Will I do it? Hopefully. But there'll be a lot of tears along the way. It's fine.
Yeah, well said. I just wanted to piggyback on what Alyssa had said when you spoke about the fact that you have lofty goals, but those goals are a part of the collective vision board of your life. And so not because they're lofty means that they're not worthwhile. And as I spoke about being, you know, firm on your objective, but flexible on the path, it's worthwhile to put that goal down and say this is something that you want to do and not make light of it or think that it's out of this world, because I think before we applied to MIT, MIT was out of this world, you know, and so many other things. So honor your right to put that out there. We won't know exactly how it will happen, but I do think there's a lot to be said even in the philosophy of The Secret and other things about just putting out in the world what you want. Be willing to dare and be bold. And if your dreams don't scare you, then they may not be big enough. You know, your dreams should scare you. So you heard Professor Lee talk about the fact that I'm training for a triathlon. I am currently learning to swim. I am scared as ever about my goal. But that's what makes me show up to swim class, because I'm going to be in open water. And if I don't know how to swim, it will be a problem. I have paid down for it already. And see, I'm putting it in my bio. I'm keeping myself accountable. So that's okay too. So for me, I would love to be UN Secretary General. And I'm putting it out there. UN Secretary General, right? And so there are many different paths that one can take to that point. But when I was an undergrad, I really wanted to work at the UN. And I remember there was a conference happening in New York. And the Secretary General's ombudsman was a Jamaican woman. And I said, I'm going to go to this conference. I'm going to meet her. I'm going to tell her what I want to do. And I hope she can help me, you know. And there was a friend who was living in New York. A girlfriend and I went and we like slept on he gave us his bed because he's a gentleman. And, you know, was it very get there late, get to the conference as soon as we can. And I was speaking to the assistant of the Secretary General's ombudsman. And this assistant is like, who is this university student thinking she can meet with the Secretary General ombudsman? And so he really wasn't facilitating the meeting. So I was back and forth with him. And by the time I got there, still no meeting. And I'm thinking, if this man thinks my ancestors were brought from Ghana on a ship, got nothing to eat, were beaten all their lives, some of them killed, some of them I think about the fact that there is defiance in not killing yourself. Like these people, in the context of my enslaved ancestors, right? Because they could have taken that way out. But they decided that though their families were separated, though they were going through hell, they were going to live through it. And I said, if I got all the way to MIT and I've gotten to the UN in New York and I'm not going to meet with her, here's another thing coming. So at the end of the day, of course, no meeting, right? And I went around people, hey, I'm trying to meet with the Secretary General Ombudsman. I don't know where she is. And I found out the room number and I went and I was like, hi, I'm Ayanna. I'm the one who sent you 500 emails and I want to, and I think he's literally like, she's crazy. She came to this office, she's crazy. I don't know that I'm face to face with her, how I'm going to get a pass to not meet with her. So the meeting was facilitated, but my eyes and my energy said, literally, if I have to crawl over you, I'm going to meet with her. And of course, when I met with her, she was very, very sweet. A lot of people protect people in higher positions, and then when you meet the person, they're very nice. So I said to her exactly what I wanted to do. Be clear on what you want, right? My name is Ayanna Samuels, and I want to work at the UN, you know? And she was like, oh, great, I'll introduce you to some people. The woman went out, worked the room. You'd have thought we knew each other. This is Ayanna. She goes to MIT. She really, I'm like, wow, thank you so much. And that eventually led to my having a position with the UN in Geneva. Fantastic. Thank you. Thank you so much. And when I say eventually, you know, there really were pitfalls because as a Jamaican, I needed a visa to go to Geneva. And I applied for the unpaid internship. And I needed to know whether I had been accepted or not in order to facilitate the visa application. And in Geneva, they really weren't taking me on. And at the end of the day, they told me I hadn't been accepted. And I'm like, wow, I'm in graduate school. This is an unpaid internship. And I wasn't accepted. Maybe I should just go and be a professional dancer. This is not working out. That was very, very hard on me. But then when I spoke to my contact who had worked there before, when he spoke with them, I had been accepted. But the admin assistant was annoyed at my emails and just told me I wasn't. And I thought to myself, but the real story is, too, that I'm a little black girl from a poor country. Why do you think you have a right to be at the UN? Are you serious? You think there's a seat for you here? And so there's so much I learned from that. So the next year, I applied again. And when I got there, I was the only person from Jamaica there, but really tried to make the best of it and learned that the Secretary General of the International Telecommunications Union was a human just like us. He put on his pants 1 foot at a time. My mother always says that. And so I said, no, this is something I can do too. So when I left, I said to myself, okay, if I were to return to Jamaica, that's the advice I got. I can be on the front lines of development work because I'd be such a unique kind of professional there. And I would work for about 5 years and then fill my development knapsack with experiences. And I want to go back to the UN at that point, because if you go to the UN right after graduation, you can be like an executive paper pusher. You're not really getting to do real, you know, development work. And lo and behold, that was my dream, right? I woke up with it, I went to bed with it. And 5 years after, there was someone from my internship who was at a conference in Jamaica. I went and I spoke with him, and he invited me to return to Geneva. So I returned to Geneva then, was there for 8 months, really learned, solidified my French and solidified opportunities. Things didn't work exactly as I wanted them to. The love of my life at the time was ready to marry. I was so excited, returned to Jamaica for that. That did not happen. It was crazy, cray cray. And after that, I was out of a position for like 7 months. It was really, really very depressing. But then you rise from that again. And now, 7 years hence, I realize had I gotten into a situation that wasn't serving me personally, it would have taken me down completely. And so it's so important to still have these lofty goals, these amazing goals that kind of scare you. And you can put them on a vision board. Be very careful with whom you share them. Mm-hmm. Because there are many people out there that find more comfort in telling you this isn't possible than it is. So be very guarded about that. And the moment you get negative energy, cross that person off the list of people who you're going to share with. And that person may even be your mother or your father. You know, at a certain point, and then there's certain things you share with them. You know, you don't ask a pauper for financial advice, and just remember that with regard to who we speak to, you know, and be fierce about it and be relentless. And, you know, as 50 Cent, what is it, 50 Cent? That was the rapper? Do it or die trying. Was it 50 yeah. Cent?
Was that 50?
Get rich or die trying. Yeah. So, yeah, there we go.
I thought you were going to go to DJ Khaled.
No.
We the best.
That works too. Thank you.
I do want to say one thing. So, I am currently at a point in my life where 10 years, I have no idea what that means for me. And I have found it extremely helpful to create SMART goals that I know that I can achieve, and so then I can feel good about myself for these small goals, mm-hmm. So that I don't feel bogged down by the fact that I'm not achieving large goals, or these goals are really far away, and so I have got no concrete measures of success. I think something that really resonated with me when you guys were speaking is when you're charting your own path, what does indicators of success look like? Mm-hmm. And so one thing that I do a lot is I reflect on, okay, well, what does success look like for me? And mm-hmm. so it's important for me to feel good about myself. Okay, that's really obvious. It's important for me to feel good about myself. How do I do that? I achieve my goals. What's a small goal that I can do? So 10 weeks... well, actually more about like 7 or 8 weeks, I'm going to be running a 5K, trying to get on that Ayanna status. and, you know, that's a small goal that isn't related to me being Secretary of Education directly, but I feel like you got to have stamina for that job, right? So, like, might as well. Yeah, I think so. Maybe you don't need to actually be qualified, as we have seen from our... But, thank you.
With regard to the 10-year question, one thing to point out is that it becomes easier as you get older, because 10 years get shorter.
I like that.
I like that. Yes, yes.
I like that.
So I think about things that might influence science policy and how I might be able to engage our government in understanding the importance of science, its role in people's lives, and how to move it forward, get more funding for it, mm-hmm. and get more women of color, more women in general involved in it. So I'm thinking about how I can be seated or positioned in a place where I can do that. And I've been observing from my colleagues how that might be possible. So one of the things that I think about for the future.
That's awesome.
It really is. Yeah.
I don't know whether people need to leave. We have room for
till five.
But first of all, I want to say the writer Annie Dillard says this thing, but what you said, Ayanna, reminded me that you have to stop your calling. You know, you have to go back.
Oh, I love that.
Stop your calling.
I love that.
So I was thinking about that as you spoke. So I was thinking about the circuitous path, and you know, I didn't have the wisdom that Khalea had to quit Harvard Law School. I went on and finished an Ashley work for 9 years miserably as a lawyer or doing something, you know, related to that field. But people often have said, well, what, you know, and I'm a fiction writer, did you learn things in the law that have been at use, that have been of use in your fiction writing? And one thing I thought of is that I really learned about how about attention to the implication of each word chosen, right? Because in a legal document, you know, one word compares to the name of the document and can expose your client. And so I think that's been of use, like that attention to that kind of detail in my writing. So I want to ask if each one of you could say something that you learned in the discipline that you studied at MIT, then maybe you aren't doing, you know, that same discipline now, but one sort of lesson or skill that you learned that has been transferable to a different kind of discipline or pursuit? Because I think that it often works that way. I don't know who was.
I can start. Okay, so when I was in graduate school, I was working with satellite communications constellations, and I was simulating it in the space systems lab. And, you know, tons of code with all these satellites coming together, and a lot of it was legacy code I inherited. And I remember literally the day before the dual thesis was due, I was cranking at this, and it wasn't working. And I called my professor feeling like, all right, I'm not going to graduate. You know, I'm just giving you a heads up. And he thought of something that we could test, and I did that test, changed maybe, I don't know, two aspects of lines of code, and it worked brilliantly. So I think a lot of times, especially for those who don't have maybe lowering your standards, they'll say, oh, it doesn't matter if you don't do this one thing, or it doesn't matter if that isn't in place. Don't worry, you know, you're being too hard on yourself. And there may be times when that's true, but sometimes one detail can matter. It's like when people say, oh, don't worry, it's just one pizza. At the end of the day, it does still have an impact, you know? And so little details can matter. Being polite matters. You know, all these things that we may think are small have gravitas. So that has been brought home to me.
Nothing is really small.
The devil really is in the details. And that ought to be remembered. And so that has been a big take home. And a second take home, I remember, again, Professor Harris had said to me that oftentimes whatever we learn in school may become defunct by the time we graduate in terms of, you know, you have pursued this PhD topic, but we know those solutions now 5 years hence after you graduate. But the real question is learning to ask yourself difficult questions and learning how to go about solving that. That will always be something that will serve you regardless of your field, even in your personal life. And so that has been a major legacy for me that has lived on.
So I can go. The thing I learned here is that the world is really small, okay? Like very, very, very small. My entire path to MIT is pretty much a story about a very small world where you just so happen to be studying with someone who's somehow connected to this institute. And for me, the first time that came, okay, maybe the third time, that came full circle was I had a marketing professor here. I will not tell you her name. We did not like each other, right, at all. You know, she came in on the first day of class, and she basically said, I'm a woman, and I look like this, but I'm from Texas, and I have no sympathy. This is a meritocracy. Boom. And I was like, wow, she has really negative energy. So I was myself. I was very ornery, very stubborn in her class. I was not a great student. I ended up having to challenge my grade in her class. Fast forward to when I was on the job market, I did not get a job at Emory because at the end of my interview, she remembered who I was. The world is small. And there is people have this memory, right? They may not remember you specifically, but when you do stuff that's rude and cruel and unnecessary, it does tend to stick with people. Mm-hmm. And I mean, look, I didn't not get the interview because she remembered exactly who I was, but I was on the edge, right? Because one of my friends works at that university. I was on the edge. And she, when she got in the meeting, she just said no. She's not collegial. End of story, right? So be careful a bit about remembering that the world is small, right? You are more memorable than you know. Trust me. And just sort of be aware of how you're coming across.
That's good advice.
Good advice.
I'd say there's a definite overlap between what drew me to civil engineering and what draws me to media, in that I think in both cases, both with the construction of buildings or bridges, whatever, there's the project itself is well-defined, it's entirely self-contained, and it's permanent. And I feel the same is true of a television show or a film project. It is well-defined, it's entirely self-contained, and it is permanent. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, I'm attracted to projects that feel like that. I think as far as skill sets that might have been learned in school that are transferable now, I think, you know, in engineering, you're looking and you're designing, obviously for strength, and, you know, whatever you're designing is only as strong as its weakest element. Mm-hmm. So you're always looking for weakness. And I think similarly, this sounds bad, but in a political television show, you're looking for the flaws in logic in whoever mm-hmm. you're interviewing. You're mm-hmm. looking for their record on particular issues, and you're looking for the contradictions. And so I think that has been transferable also.
I'm really enjoying this panel. I'm learning a lot. So what is different about chemistry and education is basically everything. In chemistry, it's beautiful. It's like things make sense and things happen for a reason. But when you're in education, you're dealing with people, and they have feelings and motivations and biases, and they bring all of this to the table, and it's not even about what it's about anymore. And so I've had to learn a lot how to deal with people, which is not my strong suit. But one thing that I did learn from chemistry that I'm really glad I know is how to do the boring thing and the value that can come out of doing the boring thing, because mm-hmm. lab work is not fun. Like, there is not always, sometimes lab work is fun, okay? Sometimes it is enjoyable, but for the most part, you are trudging along and you're repeating the same process with a slight variation over and over again, hoping that something will happen. I worked for an entire summer on something that ended up being useless. And I didn't know it was useless because I couldn't see what it actually was until the 10th week. And when I saw what it was, I was like, gosh, you're pretty, but you do nothing.
Process.
Oh, so I'm talking about purely the chemical compound.
But that's another way to look at it. Exactly.
Right.
Right. And our disciplines as a process.
Yes.
Yes.
Absolutely.
And there have been lessons learned.
What I mean about this is that there is strength in the process and in the diligence and the perseverance, and being a scientist taught me to embrace that and not to feel like just because I'm not seeing results every single day that what I'm doing is not worth something in the end.
All right. And I'm going to turn Helen's question around a little bit because it's interesting. I'm working in the field I studied, but at MIT, I took several humanities courses. And my minor, I mentioned that I wanted to be a writer, so my minor was in literature, or not minor, but concentration. Okay. And I chose, I think at that time, it was Shakespeare, but I took maybe three or four other classes in literature because I still had that strong, you know, connection with the written story. And what I learned from those experiences is that there is a story in everything, that if you can learn how to tell it, you can change the world. Mm-hmm. The power of the story is something that I got out of my humanities education at MIT, yeah. But it's incredibly important to me now, because like I said, you gotta convince people to give you money to do the things that you want to do as a scientist, and you have to be able to convey to them the importance of what you've done once you've discovered something and you want to share it with the world. So I use that every day now.
The power of the story.
The power of the
story.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Really
is.
Yeah.
Shall we wrap up,
or is there one last?
Such a poetic ending.
Yeah.
Good ending.
Thank you for having us. Thank you.